So first of all, thank you all for joining our Conversations in Genetics webinar today. This is our sixth webinar in the series. And if you're interested, we do have recordings of our past webinars, the other five webinars that we've done. So we'll be posting the link to, you know, for how you can find those in the chat box. But just so you know, the funding support for our webinar series is provided by the Nurse Support Program 2, which is administered by the Maryland Higher Education Commission, funded under the auspices of the Health Services Cost Review Commission. Today, our topic is demystifying genetic testing. And I know I'm very excited to hear all about this topic, as I'm sure many of you are. And we're very fortunate to have an incredible speaker today, Wei Mu, who is a certified genetic counselor at the Department of Genetic Medicine at Johns Hopkins University. She received her Master of Science in Genetic Counseling from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health and is certified by the American Board of Genetic Counseling. She has a special interest in neuropsychiatric genetics. She specializes in dementias and movement disorders, including Parkinson's disease, Huntington's disease, and hereditary ataxias. She loves working with patients and enjoys teaching all levels of learners. She has a special interest in multicultural counseling and international development of the genetic counseling field. So as I said, we're very, very lucky to have her today. Today, she's going to discuss the basics of genetic testing and how to read and interpret genetic laboratory reports. You can submit questions throughout the webinar. In fact, we would love it if you would submit questions throughout the webinar. Feel free to put questions in the chat box. And we will have a Q&A component built into the webinar, definitely some time during the end, but we also have some patient cases and we would love to have audience interaction for those as well. So when we get to that portion, we'll give you some more instructions on how to interact. But again, feel free to submit your questions in the chat box as we go along. And we also have two moderators today, and they are both from our grant team. First, we have Jen Wilder, who is an oncology nurse by training, who works in the stem cell transplant field. She works at the National Institutes for Health with patients undergoing transplant on clinical trials at the NIH Clinical Center in Bethesda, Maryland. Jen is also finishing up her DNP in the clinical nurse specialist track here at Hopkins and will continue working to bring awareness to genetics and awareness of genetics and genomics to nurses and other professionals at the NIH. And she's graduating soon and she certainly won't be escaping me. I will definitely be very much in touch with her. It's been very, very great on a personal level, Jen, to work with you over the last couple of years. We also have Teresa Luperchio, who is a molecular geneticist. She earned her PhD at the Johns Hopkins School of Medicine, where she focused her studies on epigenetics, third nuclear structure and gene regulation, and a postdoctoral fellowship working on epigenetic disorders and specifically Kabuki syndrome. Teresa is interested in expanding genetic testing utility and technologies to help shorten the diagnostic odyssey for patients and families. And she's also the program manager for our grant right now, and also just have absolutely enjoyed working with her over the last year. So without further ado, I will turn things over to Wei Yi.
Thank you so much for the introduction. I'm honored to be speaking with you all about how to utilize genetic testing in clinical practice. So based on everyone's feedback, this will hopefully be a very practical and a practical talk focused on how to actually order testing, what goes into variant interpretation. There's too much information to cover in just an hour long talk. I should mention that to really fully develop the skills of ordering and interpreting testing, most clinicians will go through a rigorous training program, like a master's of genetic counseling program or a genetics residency. So by no means you should expect to come out of this talk being able to utilize these skills daily, but we were hoping to provide you with some context, familiarity with this process as a starting point to learn more. So I only have a few background slides, but I thought it was important to remind everyone of how prevalent clinical genetic testing has become, not just in genetic medicine, but really across all specialties. So some of you may have seen this diagram before. This is a graph depicting the cost per genome from when we first did the human genome sequencing project in the early 2000s to 5 years ago, the cost has really dropped. You can really see an inflection point around 2007 to 2008. And that's when next generation sequencing technologies became readily available. A similar but inverse curve is happened in gene discovery. This is a graph actually using ataxia as an example. So in the study of ataxia, which is a group of heterogeneous genetic disorders, gene discovery was going at a pretty steady rate until around the same time, a few years later, after around 2010, 2011, you can see the rate of gene discovery went up sharply. And that's also due to the rise in availability of next generation sequencing. Additionally, attitudes towards genetic testing has really become more positive. A lot of interest from the general public towards genetic testing, data sharing, towards things like ancestry. The number of direct-to-consumer genetic testing companies have grown. And as you may know, they not only provide data like ancestry, but also some health genetic risks as well. And this graph just shows how many customers have submitted samples to these popular genetic testing companies. We'll talk a little bit about 23andMe today, but there are, of course, other companies. In addition to the ancestry data, there are health risk profiles based on your genetic data as well that are provided. So some of our patients may be coming to us having done genetic testing already. Well, that's just a little background. So the things I'd like to cover today are briefly describing the types of genetic testing, going over the basics of report interpretation, as well as going over some case examples for us to practice. So I'm hoping this will be interactive. So please use the chat feature to submit questions. And I'll be pausing at 2 or 3 points during the discussion. So genetic testing overview, just so we're all on the same page, I share this slide with patients as well. Clinical genetic testing is typically done on a blood sample or a saliva sample. We've been using saliva samples a lot during the era of COVID because the patients do not have to come to the hospital. They can do these at home. And you're either getting leukocytes or fibroblasts, and the clinical genetic testing lab extracts the DNA and analyzes whatever portion of the DNA they're interested in assessing and produces a test result report, which then gets shared back to the clinician who's ordering the test. I made this table many years ago, and changed the pricing, but overall the data is still true. This is a list of some of the most common clinical genetic tests that we order. And I keep saying clinical because if some of you are involved in research protocols, you'll say, oh, well, the cost is actually a lot lower. That's because the cost for a clinical test is increased because of the cost of interpreting the data. I'm gonna highlight 3 or 4 of these technologies specifically. We're not going to go over this table in detail. If you have access to the recording, you can certainly pause here and take a look, but I just want to highlight that there are different ways to assess the genome. There are different technologies, and really the focus here for a clinician is what are these technologies able to detect and what are their limitations? So for example, many of you may be familiar with the chromosome microarray test. We'll talk about that in a little more detail. So I'll be going over each of these tests as well as whole exome sequencing. But you can take a quick scan and see, okay, some of these tests are cheaper, $300 or so. And these are all estimates and ranges, but it could go up to a couple thousands of dollars, especially when we're going to the bottom of the list here where we're doing genomic testing, whole exome, whole genome testing. Makes sense, more data, more analysis, higher the cost. So again, just to highlight the common tests that we sent to order. And when choosing a test, you're also thinking about what are these tests detecting? So a really brief genetics lesson, you may remember the nucleotide sequence, the nucleotides code for amino acids, which then become proteins. Well, many most next generation sequencing tests try to detect missense or single nucleotide variants or small variants in the genome. But there are certain types of mutations, like a repeat expansion mutation, that are not easily detectable by these tests. So when you're thinking about what test you're using, you should think backwards a little bit and think about what you're trying to detect. So if I am interested in assessing whether my patient has Fragile X syndrome, that's not going to be picked up on whole exome sequencing. So let's say you got a patient and they've had whole exome and I'm wondering, gosh, did they have Fragile X testing? Well, if I look up Fragile X syndrome, I realize, oh, the mutation is actually a repeat expansion, and that is not detectable on a whole exome platform. So the types of mutations are very important to keep in mind. And I just use this diagram just to show you the same thing I just showed you on the last page, but this is something I present to patients often. So I use an analogy when explaining technologies to patients that genes are like sentences in a chapter, or sometimes I use the analogy that it's a recipe for a particular protein. And we're trying to detect aberrations in the sentence. And there's different types of mutations, and there's different types of testing to detect those mutations. I had a very smart genetic counseling student a semester or two ago who used the analogy that the next gen sequencing tests were like spell checkers, but the repeat expansion tests were like grammar checkers. So a spell checker would not pick up a repeat expansion mutation because that's the correct spelling. But you know, just thinking about these things from what you're trying to detect perspective. And patients usually pick up this pretty easily and understand what we're trying to detect. Okay, so now we're going to go into each specific commonly ordered genetic test. So some of you are familiar with the karyotype. If you were in school back in the day when we did our own karyotypes, you may have done one yourself. So karyotypes are still sometimes used in clinical practice. You may remember that it's just a picture of your chromosomes, and using G-banding staining, you can detect some level of aberrations within the chromosomes. You can easily detect aneuploidy. There's an entire chromosome 21 Down syndrome. You can detect that, as well as smaller deletions or duplications or structural variations like a ring chromosome. However, in almost all cases, and especially in pediatric practice, we're using a chromosome microarray instead of a karyotype. And chromosome microarray is also looking for aberrations in the amount of DNA that someone has. But the sensitivity is much higher. It's using a high density SNP profile. So I don't have time, unfortunately, today to explain this extensively, but using the recipe book analogy, if you think of your DNA as a recipe book and it's all of these 3 billion DNA letters and a big book, I've explained to patients that a microarray is like flipping through the pages at that resolution to see if there's extra missing pages. It's not reading through every letter on those pages. And technical details include that this test can detect two pieces of information. One is copy number variants. So are there missing pieces of DNA along any chromosome? So missing pages or extra pages will be detected. And we call those missing or extra DNA segments copy number variants. Not all copy number variants are pathogenic, right? Actually, there are many copy number variants, especially small ones that are benign and passed down in families and do not seem to cause any medical conditions. But and we'll talk about classification variants later, just because you get a copy number variant on a report doesn't necessarily mean it's pathogenic, but some of the more famous pathogenic copy number variants include 22q deletion syndrome, aka DeGeorge syndrome. And the diagnostic yield of some of those syndromes for patients with developmental delay is something like 15 to 20%. So we do use microarrays to detect copy number variants for patients with delays in autism, as well as multiple congenital anomalies. These are some of the 3 main indications for SNP array. Now, the second piece of information a SNP array can tell us is whether at a particular SNP. So again, if you're thinking about the recipe analogy, it's like the way they detect extra missing pages is at a particular letter. you're seeing if that letter is duplicated or missing, and you're seeing what letter that is, and so what nucleotide it is in the genome. So that's called a single nucleotide polymorphism. So a SNP array can detect whether, compared to a reference genome, whether this person has one copy between, so this is chromosome 7, this is just an example, between this area and chromosome 7 to this area, this person only has one copy instead of the usual two copies, so that would be a deletion. But you can also detect whether someone has homozygosity. This is a little more complex, but I think in summary, it's when someone, most of these SNPs should be different. They're polymorphisms, they are supposed to be different on each allele. Remember, we have two copies of every chromosome, but when there's long stretches of SNPs that are the same, especially if those segments are more than 3 megabases or 3 million base pairs long, we get very concerned about, could there be a loss of heterozygosity due to parents being consanguineous or there being a uniparental disomy event. So don't have time to explain that more in detail, but that can indicate that there's a higher likelihood of a recessive condition or an epigenetic or imprinting condition. So in short, a chromosome microarray can detect copy number variants, loss of heterozygosity, but it will not detect single gene mutations, right? Again, it's not looking through the letters on those pages, just looking to see whether there's extra or missing DNA in general. So single gene testing, it's as simple as that. You're looking at a single gene. So some of you can think of your favorite genes, P10, BRCA, 1 or 2. It's looking through that gene for mutations, for pathogenic variants. Traditionally done on Sanger sequencing, but now most single gene tests are done on a next generation sequencing platform. And my brief explanation is that it's just a faster, more efficient way to pick up a large scale DNA material and produce that data that's more easily analyzable, and it's on the whole cheaper, but most labs will confirm any aberrations they find on Sanger sequencing. So you should order single gene tests when you're interested in a specific condition. If you have a patient with Caffé-Allais macules and you're interested in, do they have NF1 or not? Neurofibromatosis type 1, you look up NF1, you realize there's only one gene. That's convenient. Let's order that one gene. So in that situation, it's very convenient to specifically rule in or out a diagnosis with some limitations. There are some conditions for which there are multiple genes, and then you need to order a panel. But in general, it's pretty straightforward. A negative result isn't always ruling out a condition because there are some areas of the gene that are hard to assess. For example, remember genes have exons and introns, so deep intronic mutations can't be easily detected in clinical testing. But in general, it's pretty straightforward, rule out or rule in a diagnosis. When there are multiple genes for any particular indication, you can order a gene panel. These panels range from 2 genes to sometimes hundreds of genes. In general, the more genes you order, the more likely you are to receive variants of unknown significances that are going to be something you have to work on interpreting. I'll go over those in a little more detail. But in general, examples of when to order this test is when you know there are multiple genes associated with a particular phenotype. So in PEDS, if you have a child without delays but has epilepsy, you look up, there's gene panels for epilepsy, including more than 100 genes. And it's really hard to figure out which single gene to order. You can just order a panel. So that's one situation when you might order a gene panel. And I'll briefly explain whole exome sequencing. I imagine that might be the subject of another talk, but whole exome sequencing is a technology that's used to actually assess only the exonic regions of genes across entire genome. So exons only make up 1-2% of the entire genome, but the vast majority of clinically relevant disease-causing mutations are found in exons. And so it is a way to provide some high yield data without going through the entire genome. Now, Exome interpretation is very complicated. The testing is generally longer, may take, there are rapid exomes that are able to be done, especially when the situation calls for it, like in the NICU setting. But in general, it's a few months long process. It does usually require some insurance authorization. But really the key to remember here is that exome is a phenotypically driven test. It's best used when you're interested in multiple diagnoses and multiple genes on your genetic differential, and there's not one panel that fits everything. So for example, you have congenital malformations, you also have epilepsy in your patient and delays, and there's not one panel that fits all the conditions you're thinking about, and exome will assess all of those conditions. It is, because it is phenotype driven, what I mean is that when an exome is performed, the data is filtered. It's not like you're getting a report of thousands of exons and whether the genes are positive or negative. The data is filtered based on multiple factors, whether that variant is inherited or not, but also whether it matches the patient's phenotype or not. So if you have a one-year-old who has some delays but doesn't really have other specific features, you're going to get a lower yield on your exome than if you waited another year or two and that child may have developed other symptoms, and let's say hormone imbalance, or now has been diagnosed with panhypopit and now there's endocrine issues, then you can use that data to narrow down the variants in the exome. In general, it's also advised to send parental samples with an exome for maximum efficiency. So don't have time to go into all this in detail, but just know that exome, it's very important to assess the phenotype very well before sending an exome. Whole genome sequencing is now becoming an available clinical test, although it's still largely limited to the research realm in terms of insurance coverage, but it's starting to move into clinical practice. Lots I can say about this. In general, the coverage is more even than whole exome sequencing. Again, looking at this diagram, the purple are the exons and the orange are the introns. A gene is made up of introns and exons. The coverage of each nucleotide in the gene is more even on a genome because you don't need to pull out the exome. So sometimes you'll find deep intronic or splice site variants more easily on exome sequencing. Some interesting papers for people to read if they're interested. When genome sequencing is done, it does have a slightly higher diagnostic yield than whole exome, but the genes, the pathogenic variants that are found are almost always within currently known assessed genes. Both these tests, exome and genome, are limited by the number of genes that are currently known and associated with human phenotypes. So out of 20,000 or so genes, there's about 5,000 of them, 5,000 to 6,000 of those genes that actually have a known human phenotype that is linked. So if the gene is not yet known, then you cannot find the answer on the test. Okay, I don't want to give the answer. So quickly pausing here, let's do a quick Q&A or a quick quiz on our chat. So for this case, you have a woman with early onset breast cancer. Which of these tests would you send? You can type it in the chat. And whoever is monitoring the chat can tell me. Let's see if I can look at the chat as well. Okay. Nobody is typing in the chat. So far. Oh, a couple of answers coming in. Okay, people are saying single gene, BRCA, that seems like a good answer. Uh-huh. Gene panel. Yeah, both of those are advisable. I think typically most clinical cancer genetic counselors will be ordering a gene panel because it's not just BRCA1, there's BRCA2, there's P10, there's many genes that can increase the risk for early onset breast cancer. What about this other case? 5-year-old boy with autism and developmental delay in large ears. Let's say you're trying to assess for, like you just heard me say, 22q is one of these conditions maybe you should think about. What test would you do to assess for 22q? So 22q is a deletion syndrome. So what tests would be best used to assess for chromosome deletion syndrome, SNPRI. Great. So eventually, some people are saying whole exome sequencing. Eventually, we might go to whole exome sequencing. And actually, there is some data suggesting that whole exome sequencing might be higher yield than a SNPRI as a first-line genetic test. Both of those answers would be appropriate. But specifically, the question is, I want to assess for 22q. Whole exome sequencing wouldn't necessarily pick that up because it's used to detect single gene variants. Okay, any questions on the chat? So I'm just pausing here. I'm going into the next section about actually ordering clinical genetic tests. So pausing to see if there's any questions about clinical genetic tests and how they are utilized. I know it went really quickly and don't have time to really go over that in detail.
Can you go back one slide, Wayne? So on the... I'm getting a feedback. Well, that's me. I just have a question for you about when you're looking at the whole exome sequencing versus a gene panel. Are various are those tests more likely than others to pick up variants of unknown significance? Like if you were to do whole exome sequencing versus a SNP array, would you find more things that you don't really know how to interpret if you test more genes?
Okay, so yes, I failed to mention, and just for lack of time, whole exome sequencing, anytime you're doing genomic sequencing, you have the possibility of getting results not related to the phenotype you're assessing for. So that's true of a SNP array as well. So the short answer to your question is no, I don't think in short, any of these tests are, whole exome is more likely to find incidental findings than a SNP array. A SNP array can also find incidental findings like consanguinity. You can sometimes find that on a SNP array when you're trying to assess whether a patient had 22q. Anytime you're doing genomic testing, when you're not looking just at a single gene or a set of genes, you can get results unrelated to the phenotype you're assessing, which are called secondary variants. And on large gene panels as well, when gene panels are more than 100 genes, you might get a lot of variants of unknown significance as well. So I think that's something to keep in mind for all genetic testing. Okay. Anything else before we move on to the next section? So maybe I'll spend about 15 minutes here and then we'll try to use the last 15 minutes for cases. So ordering clinical genetic testing. So once we decide what disorder we want to do testing for. So let's say it's our patient with, I think I used an example of a patient with ataxia. So there are websites for this. You do have to make a login. This is a website called Concert Genetics. So you can look that up. You can make a free login or you can just Google and search clinical genetic tests. So this is a free resource, but it does aggregate the multiple currently available genetic testing companies. And most of the clinical genetic testing companies out there are CLIA certified, they're regulated, but they do have some notable differences I'll talk about. So when you're interested in figuring out what condition you want or what gene you want, you can put that in this field and it will pull up a list of laboratories that offer testing for that indication or for that gene. You can also search on your favorite lab's website. And there are many, many factors to consider. We don't have time to cover all of this. One is, is this lab test for the condition you're interested in? Is it offering the right test? One example that I like to use is Huntington's disease. I see many patients with Huntington's disease. You can actually sequence the Huntington's disease gene, and some labs will offer sequencing, but actually the mutation we're interested in is repeat expansion. So sequencing will not get me the answer I want. So you really want to make sure it's the right test that you're looking for that will answer the question you want for the patient. The labs, when you pull up the labs, it will list if it's available on the lab's website, the cost of the test, the turnaround time. When you are working in the field for a while, for those of us who are working clinical genetics, we also are familiar with each lab's reporting, their customer service, and not just in terms of how nice they are, it's actually what backup do they have to help you answer questions. For example, when I have an unusual variant found, can I call the lab and talk to the molecular geneticist or genetic counselor who wrote the report and ask questions and get some information on whether they can help me with familial testing if I need to then test the family members? And what experience that they have. Do they have their own proprietary databases? A famous example is Myriad, a genetic testing company that really held the patent for BRCA1 and 2 testing for many years. And so they have more history of experience in testing for those genes than other labs and actually don't release data to the general public. So that they, some people may prefer to send to a lab that has that experience so that they're less likely to call a variant unknown significance if they have experience in databases to back their variant interpretation. Do laboratories have the ability to field calls from nurses or patients? Yes. So most labs will talk to the ordering provider, not necessarily to the patient, but it doesn't have to be a genetic counselor calling. Okay. So in short, I'm happy to talk about this more if people are interested. If let's say your patient has ataxia or a developmental delay, you're trying to first think, what am I wanting to get out of a genetic test? Not just should I do a genetic test, but what do I want out of this genetic test? What genes are associated and what kinds of mutations? And then you can think about what labs offer the genetic testing. So this just, we're not going to go over this in detail, but just to highlight all of the logistical steps of ordering the genetic test. Different labs are in network with different health insurance companies, and they all have their own separate policy on whether or not they'll contact the patient directly or do a pre-authorization with you, or whether, so each insurance company also has its own nuances of whether they'll cover the test. So in general, the process is, let's say it's that patient with developmental delay, that five-year-old patient in our last example. You've decided you really want to assess for copy number variants, like 22q, and you want to order a SNPRI. So you've decided that. You then can look to see what labs you may want to send to. You might look on a website like Concert Genetics, or you might know, oh, LabCorp and Quest, like those are my go-to labs. You look in LabCorp and Quest website and you find, oh, they do offer a SNPRI, great. And then you have to figure out whether the patient's insurance requires pre-authorization. So you may go on the LabCorp website and then decide, okay, let me figure out which genetic test I want to order. So I will also mention that for a common genetic test like a SNP microarray, there might be many different iterations of this. Want to make sure you're ordering the right one. So let me just pull up, hopefully you can see my screen still. So you Google LabCorp SNP microarray and then you see, oh, there's two of these. This one says prenatal, that's probably not the right one, but some of them are a little more tricky to find out. So then you click on the test you want and then you notice there's a CPT code here. So you or the patient will have to call their insurance and see if their insurance covers that CPT code. Hopefully this is not too practical. This is hopefully helpful information. So then once you figure out, it might take some filling out of paperwork, and some insurances do require that the patient has to see a genetic counselor, a geneticist before you can offer the testing. So you have to go back and forth with them. But then hopefully if they say yes, pre-authorization is not required, or you've got the approval, great, you can have the patient do the test. So then you can have the patient actually complete the testing, see what sample is available for the lab to help you order. LabCorp and Quest usually do blood draws, but for other more esoteric tests, like a P10 test or some of the BRCA testing, you may need to figure out whether the patient can have their blood drawn and how much this test will cost the patient if insurance is not paid. So anyway, lots of logistics that go into the actual finding and ordering of the genetic testing. And sometimes it involves a back and forth with the insurance, with the denial and the letters of medical necessity. So it can get a little bit complicated. I was asked to really briefly mention consent. So when discussing genetic testing with patients, it's usually advisable not to tell them we're definitely going to do genetic testing because sometimes their insurance may not cover it. So when if you hinge your clinical conversation around like, yeah, this is definitely the right thing to do, but then their insurance doesn't cover it, then therapeutically that doesn't help the patient in some ways. So it's helpful for you to let them know it's a process and that you will help them with the process. We don't know if insurance will cover it and we can check. And there is a whole other discussion that we can have about how to provide informed consent for testing. As nurses, you're well equipped to provide informed consent on a variety of topics. So I think genetic testing is no different than some of the other things you provide consent for. Similarly, there might be conclusive diagnoses, there might be normal results that aren't necessarily clarifying or completely ruling out a condition. And like most medical tests, genetic tests can have uncertainties, right? There could be variants of finding significance. It's not necessarily different from ordering a brain MRI and finding an unknown spot that then has to be assessed further. There are some notable differences. One is that because genetic testing can have a predictive effect, you could be finding a variant that has implications for the future, but not now, right? And the second main difference for genetic testing is that there are often implications for the family. You sometimes diagnose one patient with Fragile X, and then you end up diagnosing their mother with ovarian insufficiency and their grandmother with tremor ataxia syndrome. So there are usually implications for the family that is helpful to set expectations for patients and families beforehand so they know. And just to remind everyone that if you refer the patient to a genetic counselor or a clinical geneticist, the genetic counselor and the geneticist's job includes all of the above things that we talked about, including assessing insurance, but also the job of informing the family of what to expect when you do the test and taking care of all of the interpretation, the follow-up, including whether or not to offer familial testing. And also really help the families adapt to the genetic information. That's one of the specific trainings of a genetic counselor. Not just what the results are, but what they mean for the families. Where in the list does consent happen? Consent can happen at any point. Sometimes I do consent before discussing insurance. Sometimes we discuss consent after we get insurance approval. So I don't think consent should be necessarily a piece of paper and a 5-minute or 1-hour process. I think consent is best utilized in the context of a continuous patient relationship and dialogue. You just have to know that when you send the test, hopefully the patient has already had some conversations with you. So let's make sure we have some time for report interpretation. So you finally send off the test that you wanted and you're waiting for the results. And like we showed you in the table earlier, the results might take anywhere between a few weeks, 2 or 3 weeks to a few months. Recently, some of the genetic testing labs that we've been sending to have been inundated with high volumes and the results might take 4 or 5 months to come back if it's a whole exome. Before we talk about the details of their interpretation, I don't know what genetics background everyone has, so I just want to show you one or two diagrams to really set the context for genetic variants and what impact they have on phenotype. I really, really like this graph. I show it to my patients sometimes. This graph describes the contribution of genetics and environment or a combination thereof to a particular disease phenotype. So on the x-axis, we have the different levels of genetic contribution. So there could be sporadic conditions. So the current favorite example is COVID, right? Which is not a genetic condition, it's sporadic. And yet some people, perhaps with different genetic susceptibilities or other susceptibilities, have more severe cases, right? So it's not all environment either. And again, if you add up genetic plus environment, you'll get the disease threshold. So on the y-axis is what contribution of these factors result in the disease phenotype. So on the far right side of the x-axis spectrum, you have your monogenic conditions like Down syndrome. One chromosome explains the vast majority, if not all, of the disease phenotype, Fragile X syndrome, 22q deletion syndrome. But let's take an example of BRCA. BRCA1 and BRCA2 are not monogenic conditions. When someone is born, if they live a healthy lifespan, they have a BRCA gene mutation, they may not necessarily develop the disease phenotype. There are other genetic factors. So I would say BRCA is one of these high risk genetic conditions that might fall in this area, but there's some environmental contributions as well, right? And for your patients, it's helpful to know that there are environmental modifiers that could reduce the risk even if you have the genetic variant. For example, bilateral mastectomy, oophorectomy, that can actually reduce your risk even if you cannot change a genetic status. Some of the genetic tests that are available clinically, the vast majority of them are going to be single gene, specific gene, but there are many tests available, especially in the direct-to-consumer testing range that are in this multifactorial or polygenic range. So be very careful. From population-based studies, many patients may have an idea of genetic determination. So if I have this gene variant, I'm definitely going to get this phenotype, but actually we want to keep that in context, make sure we understand which gene is this, what phenotype you're interested in, and how much of this genetic contribution may actually be involved in the disease threshold. Hopefully that makes sense, but just to set the framework a little bit. Now we're going to talk a little bit about variant interpretation. So when someone's genes are sequenced, DNA is sequenced, their genotype is found. So this is using next generation sequencing as an example, but you can use this for anything like copy number variant analysis. So it's compared to the reference. There's always a database of normal reference genomes or standard or population variants included reference genomes. And then an interpretation is made. So there's five categories of variants. In 2015, American College of Medical Genetics made standard guidelines for variants to be classified into one of five categories: benign, likely benign, variant of unknown significance, likely pathogenic, and pathogenic. Before 2015, the reports were a lot more varied. Sometimes they were called mutations, sometimes they were called many other things. So they're basically, it was not as standardized. We're most interested in, of course, the pathogenic variant. I'm going to really quickly go over basics of variant interpretation. So there's many things that go into this. There's a lot of complex diagrams. So things for you to know as a clinician are that the clinical correlation is very important. If there's an uncertain variant, but it doesn't fit at all with the patient's phenotype, maybe that's not very relevant. The process is subjective. It may change with familial studies. Let's say you have a child and a mother both with seizures, and there's a variant that's of unknown significance, but that's inherited from the father who doesn't have seizures. That's probably not the variant you're looking for, and that information may cause the variant to be downgraded to benign. This is a process that changes over time as more people get tested. The significance of variants in the classification does change. So we get reports back all the time that say, your patient got a report in 2016, but now we've downgraded the variant and now it's no longer considered pathogenic, or it is now considered pathogenic. Usually variants are downgraded. So it's a very complex process, and there is some subjectivity to it too. This is complicated, but just because we're running out of time, I just want to say the majority of variants are going to fall into this VUS category. When I first started working and when I was in grad school, I thought, my goodness, a VUS again? You know, I am so unlucky. I'm getting so many VUSs. Actually, the majority of variants are in a VUS category because there's not enough evidence to prove it one way or another. This is just to say there are many attempts to have a central resource for interpreting variants. So if you have a rogue lab that is reporting a variant, you're trying to figure out, is this actually disease causing or not? There's not one standard place to look. I'm going to give you some places to look. This is more reading about variant classification if you are interested about how variant nomenclature came to be. But for your information, this is something that changes over time. It's complex. There's And this is really the clinical lab's job to figure out. So in general, when you as a clinician, you're getting the report, you don't have to worry about necessarily reinterpreting the variant. You can go with the lab's assessment. But if you have a lab report that's from a while ago, you may then have to make a call yourself or reach out to experts, your local genetic counselor, or genetics staff to try to help you out. You can read the reports carefully. Most clinical labs these days are putting a lot of effort into why they call a variant one way or another. There are databases and literature you may need to assess. I don't think we have too much time to go into these details, but these are some databases that are available for assessing how common a variant is. For assessing, there are many predictive algorithms for whether a particular variant actually changes protein function or causes protein early truncation or how conservative a particular variant is. And when you go into the databases, you can see how frequently variants have been assessed, what other groups have called them. I'm going to go over one of them just for a minute. ClinVar is a provider and lab submitted database. So it's not something that gets updated unless someone actually updates it. I think this has Yelp reviews. So if you have this is being recorded, maybe I should ignore what I just said. There's some inaccuracies there. So, but ClinVar is basically as good as people who are reviewing the variant assess it to be. So if I have a variant and I'm trying to figure out whether it's disease causing, I can look it up in ClinVar. You can go to the website. I usually just Google ClinVar and you can type in the variant. And this is one example. You can pull up, okay, there's one submitter. There's only been one Yelp review and that person says it's unknown significance. But you can imagine if I have another variant and there are 20 people who say this is disease causing, I might be more likely to agree with that assessment. Similarly, you know, with the Yelp review, if 20 people are saying this restaurant is terrible, maybe it really is. But if one person is making a strong assertion, maybe you should use that information with a little grain of salt. Right? And ClinVar will also tell you who assessed that variant. It does not always tell you in much more detail than that. And there are star systems for how many people have assessed this and how strong that classification is. Most entries are no stars or one star because most variants are single and rare. There are aggregation resources for single gene variants. I would just point you to two of them, maybe one of them. Franklin Genox is a free resource. You can use that. We'll practice it in a little bit. But anyway, and don't forget to search recent literature. Okay, so I'm gonna pause here. We have last 10 minutes for case examples. Any questions on variant interpretation? I'm sorry, I had to go over that rather quickly.
I just have one question.
Sure.
If you wanted the lab to review a test because it's been like a few years, would you have to send them a new sample or can they review it using an old sample?
Hello, can you hear me? Usually this is usually you don't have to send in a new sample. You can ask the lab to review, but most labs will not have the resources to automatically review and send you the report. So you shouldn't necessarily expect to be contacted by the lab. Some labs will, but if you have an old report, you can reach out to the lab directly and see if they can reinterpret that for you. It might take some time. Some labs take up to 2 months to reinterpret a variant. Okay, so let's go into our case example. So the first example is direct-to-consumer testing. So let's just call this person Miss Yuen. Miss Yuen is a 32-year-old woman who's overall healthy, has some mild health issues here and there. But she was really worried about family history of Alzheimer's disease. So she saw a deal on 23andMe. They're having a sale for Mother's Day, which they are. And she decided to go spit into the tube and ask for her health variants. And she got a result back that said, wow, she has one variant in the APOE gene. She has one copy of the E4 variant. So this is her pedigree on the side here. You can see that this is the patient. This is an epigenetic pedigree. is actually my pedigree. This grandmother died at age 86 of Alzheimer's. This is not my genetic testing report. This is some report from online, but just as an example. So the question is, should this person be concerned? What would you tell them if you were the PCP and they came to you asking for an assessment? Feel free to unmute yourself or type in suggestions or type into the chat. Has anybody gotten 23andMe reports? Feel free to raise your hand if you're in, you feel comfortable sharing. Has anyone had patients who have given you reports or brought it up?
I have my 23andMe reports, so I'm very interested.
Yes, so maybe just since we're running out of time, I'll just go into the details of the report. So, you know, you have to look up each of these variants that are on the 23andMe report. And 23andMe actually does a good job of providing information to the patient. So in my experience, most of the patients haven't had a particular question or concern. They were able to go through 23andMe. They have access to genetic counselors through the company to get information they need. So, but theoretically, if someone was concerned, APOE4 again is a risk allele. Back in our slides when we were talking about, you know, this idea of how much of a contribution does the genetics play and environment play, the APOE4 variant is one of these multifactorial, we wouldn't call it multifactorial even, it would be a risk gene, and it's a small risk gene. It's certainly a significant one in relationship to other variants that have been found. But in terms of a Mendelian condition, it is not a directly disease-causing variant. So having one copy of the E4 variant, again, we have two alleles, right, confers a 2 to 3 times higher risk for late onset Alzheimer's. When you read this, that sounds really concerning. Oh my gosh, I'm 2 to 3 times more likely to get Alzheimer's than someone who doesn't have this variant. However, what's important to keep in mind is that 13.7% of the general population has the same report as you. I often, my student Lainey Draft, who is now a neurogenetics counselor at Penn, developed this visual for a particular patient. And I think this is very helpful. This is a situation where it would be helpful to give visual reminders for what baseline risk is. Almost everybody in the general population has a lifetime risk of developing APOE, developing late onset Alzheimer's of 10 to 15%. Alzheimer's disease is very common. So everyone starts out around here on the bar, right? Someone with APOE4, yes, has a 2 to 3 times higher risk than the general person, but that risk goes up a little bit up the ladder of risk, you see? So it's not as high as someone might think, or someone with a presenilin 1 mutation who is actually at a much higher, like 90% risk of AD would have on a Mendelian risk variant. So just in short, providing contextualization for the patient. You don't have time to describe all the genetic counseling tools you would use, but for a patient like this, instead of just presenting the risk data to them directly, I usually would have a conversation with them about why they wanted to do the testing, what their concerns are, how big their fear is, and really explore what drove them to do the testing and how concerned they are. Sometimes I may even have this middle sliding scale of 0 to 100% and have them put an X on where they think their risk is. That can be a powerful risk assessment tool for a visual marker of how concerned they are. And then I can share with them, you know, your risk is actually here, and have that as a counseling tool. Really, the goal is drawing the data into an emotional and psychosocial conversation really has the highest impact for someone. You can imagine for someone who doesn't have a family history of Alzheimer's, maybe they wouldn't be as concerned, or they might say, oh, okay, you know, I'm like 32, I'm not really worried about this. It's all in context and what your patient is worried about. So case 2, pediatric patient. So let's say this is Beau, a two-year-old boy with global developmental delay. So he just transferred care to your practice, family moved from another state, and the mom's telling you, yeah, you know, he had early infants and toddlers therapy from Arizona, and now we're moving here to Maryland, and he already had PT, and now he just started walking, but he's still nonverbal. Can you help me get set up services? And then you take a history and realize he's had two febrile seizures, and you're starting to think, should I order genetic testing? So based on our conversation before, what genetic test might you want to order? Feel free to type in the chat. And don't be shy, we're not going to record the chat, right guys? So there's no penalty for wrong answers. Just want everyone's engagement and active thinking. Has anyone ordered testing for a similar patient? So Lena is wondering, maybe this is, could there be autism? Yeah, I think maybe if you were assessing this patient, maybe we would do an assessment for autism. Whole exome is a possibility, uh-huh. Yeah, so full exome could be a first-line test or a SNP array. Both of those are appropriate. So let's just say we went with the ACMG guidelines and ordered a SNP microarray. And just for practice, let's say your SNP array came back with, wow, it looks really complicated and you're worried, what do I do with this report? There's so many things on it, where do I even begin? So on the SNP array report, you can see that there are two main results that are found. The 7P14 duplication is smaller, 64 SNP markers, and then a 15Q deletion that's also small, 34 markers. So pretty small to one duplication, one deletion. So I guess we're out of time in really assessing this in more detail, but some places you might look, I will recommend that you go to you can go to Google, Gene Reviews, Rare Chromosomes database to look to see if anyone knows any information about this similar chromosome deletion. And let's say you have looked and you realize, oh, 15Q could be is a common, it includes two genes that are actually involved in the recessive conditions, right? It's actually involves a gene associated with male infertility as well as deafness, but they're recessive. And so the patient's actually a carrier. Let's actually use this next, we don't have time to explain this in more detail, but using this gene scout is another example. Let's say you want to assess this variant and you're trying to figure out which genes are in this region. So you can type in the actual markers that these are, of like Google mapping, you can figure out where this is, which genes are within this region. So you can look and you see, oh, there's some recessive genes in this region, but nothing really diagnostic, especially if it's a duplication. So it's small and the lab actually calls it a variant of unknown significance. So again, remembering that family segregation is very important. Maybe then you would order testing on the Provan's parents, and then you learn one has this duplication is unaffected, and one is a carrier for this recessive condition. So actually this SNP array is not diagnostic. So I know I went over this really fast. I'm really happy to go over this in detail if people are interested, if you have a particular SNP report, but really in summary, what I want you to take away is that there are databases to look through. Just because you find a copy number variant doesn't mean it's automatically disease causing. And if there are variants of unknown significance, you can actually follow up with parent testing. And then our last example, so Mr. Hassan is a 20-year-old man. He's establishing primary care and he says he doesn't have any health issues, but then you notice that he has a lot of dark colored birthmarks and he has very dark colored eyes. So is there a particular gene or a test that everyone is thinking you could order for this patient? NF, yeah, neurofibromatosis. So many of you may recognize this as these look like neurofibromas. Uh-huh. So let's say you say, oh, I really think you could have neurofibromatosis. Let's order an NF test. And the patient says, you know, actually, my last primary doctor said the same thing. And they ordered a test, and I think I have the report somewhere, but they said it was a variant of unknown significance. So after a long saga, you finally arrive with the report, and it says this. And it was called a variant of unknown significance. So in our last 1 or 2 minutes, let us all practice. So let's go to this Franklin Genox website and can pull it up here. And you can actually assess this variant, NF1C7089. Or you can go to ClinVar and try to look at the variant. ClinVar. So for those of you who are fast typers, do we have a punchline? Have you looked up the variant? What is the current classification? Please type it in the text. Anyone who has found the answer already?
I'm too slow, AE.
No worries. You can, hopefully this is a way to use these resources in the future to know which databases you can look at. Okay. Doesn't look like we have anyone, and we're a little out of time. So let's just cut to the chase and say, okay, you do have to figure out which variant it is. So sometimes if you're not sure, you can just assess both of these variants. Usually it's on the report. So which actual transcript is being used. But in short, this is actually pathogenic. I know there's one submitter, but this is another key is that this is actually changing the protein configuration. So now it's pathogenic, and you have a diagnosis from Mr. Hassan, you send him off to the NF clinic, he gets comprehensive care, and he thanks you for being a great provider. So hopefully we have reviewed some examples and understand what goes into this. I know it was really fast, but hopefully some of the takeaways are that this is complicated. Work with your local genetic counselor, geneticist, and know that there are many resources at your disposal. Thank you so much for the invitation to give the talk. I'm really happy to be contacted about questions in the future.
That was fantastic. Thank you so much. Oh, let's see. Maybe I need to mute. Anyway, thank you. Now I'm muting myself. Thank you. Let's try that one more time. Thank you so much. It was super. I love the practical examples. So I think maybe next time we'll have to schedule a two-part and have you back if you're interested. I want to thank everybody who joined today, and also one more thanks to the Maryland Higher Education Commission for funding the work our group is doing. I saw several members from our genetics and genomics community of practice on the webinar today, which was wonderful. And if anyone on the call is interested in joining our group, we did post the link in the chat, so reach out to us. We also posted the link to our YouTube channel, which is where you can find past conversations in genetics webinars. And then finally, I just want to say thank you to our planning committee, specifically Jen and Teresa, and also a big thanks to our multimedia team, Rafe and Florentina. So I hope you all have a great day. Thank you for hanging out for a few extra minutes, and we hope to see you next month on our conversations in genetics webinar series. Talk to y'all soon. Bye-bye.